cardiovascular inflammation and plaque is insulin resistance. And most docs in the past just looked at fasting blood glucose. When hemoglobin A1c became available, docs started looking at that as well. But we're still very, in our country as well as others, the standard medical practice is still not nearly as good as it should be in terms of diagnosing insulin resistance or prediabetes. And again, it's what drives so many parts of the aging process. Heart attack, which is the number one killer, stroke, which is the number one disabler, Alzheimer's dementia, which is quickly becoming the number one, looks to overtake maybe stroke even, already overtook stroke in the United Kingdom for death and disability. I'm going to go through some basic labs in just a few minutes. You can tell someone's status, and actually you can avoid some pitfalls as well. So why don't we look at my labs from the second Healthy Life Summit in Orlando, March 2019. Most docs, when they start looking at this problem at heart attack and stroke prevention, start thinking first about cholesterol, the bad cholesterol. And as you can see, I have a 107. That's a little bit high. It's not too bad. I'm already taking a little bit of statin, 2.5 to 5 milligrams of Crestor three times a week. So it would be a little bit higher if I weren't taking that Crestor. But that's not why I look. I look first at insulin resistance in this area. I don't look for the lipids so much, or the cholesterol. I look at triglyceride and HDL. Why do I look at that? Well, usually if you have significant insulin resistance problems going on, where you've got constantly too much insulin out there, insulin stops the burning of triglycerides, which are just fats. It also tends to chew up HDL when you have too much insulin and you have too much triglycerides. So one of the first things you can do is look for triglyceride to HDL ratio. I've mentioned that in several videos, covered that in several videos. It's a powerful predictor. And you saw on my numbers, they were great. The ratio for Caucasians, once it gets over 3, 3.5, you start worrying about insulin resistance. If it gets over 3 in people of color, Mexican Americans, you worry about insulin resistance. Even 2.5 in African-Americans, again, strong indicators of insulin resistance. You go back to my number, and mine was actually less than 1. So I was in great shape there. But let's move ahead. There's more than that to this. Now, again, pardon my my images. I'm going to have to interpret these for you. My hemoglobin A1c was 5.2. So that's a pretty good number. Actually, if you look back on some of my older videos a year or two ago, my hemoglobin A1c had crept up to 5.5, 5.6, almost 5.8, which is a number where most people would say, yep, you've got insulin resistance. So I still never had complete insulin resistance by that hemoglobin A1c number, ever. But I have it, and we'll see in just a minute. Why? Those of you who have seen some of my other videos may remember that I got a little bit too high on my vitamin D3. I got up to 90 at one point because I was getting a little bit, I got confused on when I was taking the pills. Took them twice a day for a couple of months. Stopped taking them for a while, went back to daily, and now I'm back down to 67. Thank you for your patience on that little bunny hole. Now, insulin itself, insulin should not go over actually 10 for a fasting insulin. And this number is 2.1. So that insulin number is really good as well. And actually this glucose, fasting glucose number was 84. So again, some really good looking numbers there. Most docs are not going to look at all these. If they did, they'd say, man, you are in great shape. You don't have to worry about it. I'm in great shape, but it's because I've been really watching my lifestyle. I really crank on the high intensity intervals 2 and 3 times a week, walking 5 days a week. I've got my BMI down to about 21. My waist size is 32. And I eat less than 100 grams of carbs every day, almost every day. In addition, I'm doing some water fasting 2 days a week. So I am doing a lot of stuff. But let's go back and look. These labs were drawn at the same time that those that triglyceride over HDL number of less than one, ratio of less than one was drawn. And at the same time, those that insulin number was 2.5. And at the same time, that fasting glucose was 84. Look at this. So the fasting specimen on the OGTT was 86. Again, close to 84. Quite often it'll vary a little bit more. Just helps you understand the variation of labs. And we talked about that a good bit at the Healthy Life Summit. And just to clarify for you, what we're talking about is you go in, you order fasting blood sugar with the OGTT. You also get it with other labs, such as the metabolic panel. So you're drawing the blood at the very same time and getting two slightly different numbers. 84 versus 86 is not a big deal. But again, I will classically see it 84 on one and 92 on another, or 92 on one and 98 on another. Same blood drawn at the same time. That helps you understand the kind of variation that we get with lab tests. Now, remember, up until now, everything looks pristine for me. Very, very good blood sugar levels. Uh-oh. At 1 hour after taking the 75 grams of glucose, my blood sugar is up to 183. So what's going on? I have insulin resistance. There's no question about that. I've had it for a couple of years, and as I mentioned, I've worked hard to improve it. And frankly, I have improved it. Does that mean it went away? Mm-mm. Is there an effective cure? Well, you can argue over what a cure means for type 2 diabetes or insulin resistance. That's beyond the scope of this video. If you look at my 2-hour specimen, the labs would usually say, well, just so it's below 140. Well, it's below 140, but the reality is it should be under 100. Again, there's no question that I have insulin resistance. Now, should I go ahead and do a craft insulin survey? I got it here. I could unbox it for you, but there's no need right now. We already know that I have insulin resistance. We also know that my lifestyle changes have greatly improved this. Now, let's go back and look at some other numbers from some other groups. The standard that you see for prediabetes for A1C is usually 5.7 to 6.4. And you see that on these three areas. But let's look at some other things as well. Fasting plasma glucose, they say is diabetes routinely is 126 or above. Prediabetes is 100 to 125. Normal is 99 or below. Again, I've got great numbers. A doc would look at another doc that didn't know so much about what's going on here would look at my numbers and say, you couldn't be doing better. You've got no problem. So let me help remind you in videos like the ones with old Alabama Gardener and John, I've gotten a lot of comments saying that the doctors were very bad. They didn't know what they were doing because they were missing full-blown diabetes or prediabetes. Here's why they miss it. They look at these studies and then they figure it's okay because that's the standard of medicine. As you see, the CDC and the ADA and some other groups are pushing to get us much more sensitive to our carbohydrate metabolism. We've talked about it many times before and the reasons. It drives heart attack and stroke, which are the major causes for death and disability in this country. It also drives blindness, kidney disease, the other big problems in this country in terms of health. Now, many groups, such as this one, the Latino Diabetes Association, they're saying, look, with a hemoglobin A1c up to 6 even, you're fine. Well, no, you're not. But again, I only show that to help you understand, again, some of the reasons why we have so much confusion about these very common but very, very important health conditions. If you've made it this far, I really appreciate your interest. If you hit the like button, and for sure if you subscribe or share, the algorithm reads that as a strong message that humans think this is interesting and important information. And the algorithm can share it more than any of us humans. Speaking of sharing, one of the best ways of sharing is on social media. We've got active Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn activities going on right now. We've recently started up things in Pinterest and Twitter, so we'd love to see you there. Check us out. Finally, with over 500 videos, a lot of people are saying, I can't find this video or that video. Our new social media manager, Kim Hermosa, is starting to work on ways to help with that. So join the community. You can click on the links below, and you can get a little bit better access. Thank you again for your interest.